Welcome to Beyond Bosch. I'm your host, Jessica Dell. If you haven't already, be sure to subscribe and leave a review for this episode if you like it. Today, I am so excited to have with us Stephen Brohl. He's an embedded software engineer with Bosch, and he's working on some exciting topics, some AIoT products, and also something called RideCare. I can't wait to get into it. Welcome, Stephen. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me, Jessica.
So software engineering and software in general is a hot topic these days. I'd love for you to kind of give a little bit more, first of all, of who you are, what you do, and what software engineering looks like for you.
Yeah, certainly. My name is Stephen Brohl. I'm an embedded software engineer within Bosch's cross-computational division, and I work on a team called RideCare. And I have an opportunity to work with some amazing people on some really cool cutting-edge AIoT products.
Wonderful. So how did you get into software engineering? How did you get into Bosch, that whole path? What did that look like for you?
Well, I started at Bosch about 4 years ago through an internship I earned in college. I had a classmate named Colleen that I was working at Bosch with at the time, and she was in the quality group. And her and I were going through the same cybersecurity program at Walsh College. And it just so happened I was in quite a few group projects with her. And naturally, over time, we became pretty well acquainted with one another. And she saw my skills and had mentioned a few times I'd be the right fit for a team here at Bosch. And soon after a few group projects with her and a few tutoring sessions with her, she had encouraged me to apply for an internship with the RideCare team.
Oh, that's awesome. So was she with the RideCare team at the time?
No, she was actually part of formerly Car Multimedia as a quality engineer. She had actually worked for Bosch about four and a half years.
So, okay, great. So what about before that? What led you to go down the path of software engineering?
So software engineering wasn't really a first choice for me. I originally started going to school for network engineering, so cybersecurity and network engineering.
Okay.
And software engineering just kind of evolved from everything I was learning in cybersecurity and everything that I was applying from these skills. And then I started working on Raspberry Pi and Arduino, like hobby boards or single board computers, just doing little projects and kind of learning how electronics worked on my own. And then as I got into college, I saw that quite a few of the courses I had involved these hobby boards and involved working with electronics, LEDs and diodes and stuff like that. And so it just kind of like evolved from there. And then as I had met my friend Colleen and other classmates, it just kind of sparked my interest more as I was encouraged to know more and do more with these skills. And then once I started my internship actually at Bosch, that's where it just kind of exploded. Once I really got my hands on electronics and really got to see how things worked from the ground up, I was completely enamored by it. It wasn't like I wanted to just focus on networking anymore or just focus on cybersecurity. I wanted to know all of it. I wanted to see how it all worked and just how I could make things work and bring my ideas to life.
Yeah, very cool. So I know you had mentioned you were influenced by like Hollywood movies like The Matrix, GoldenEye, and Jurassic Park to be a hacker, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I love that because I think often we do get inspired by things we see, right? Mm-hmm. And to your point, you got enamored with it all and realized you had to do a bit more, right? Like than just one topic. How did you kind of like get influenced? Did you have this always in your childhood? Was this kind of like your passion from a young age, or was it when you kind of, like you said, stumbled onto some of these things?
Well, like you had mentioned, I was kind of fascinated with Hollywood hackers and it just kind of evolved from there. So I remember as a kid, I wanted to be a hacker. I just loved what I'd seen in movies and everything that I've seen online. But the more and more I looked into it, I found that it's not just something you can easily obtain. It's a title that you earn through many, many years of experience and know-how. And so I just had this idea that if I want to earn this title, I'm going to have to do everything. I'm going to have to learn everything, and I can't just stay focused in one area. I have to learn it all. So if I want to be a hacker, I have to know the hardware, the software, and just kind of get in the mindset of the people that design and build these things.
That makes sense. So did you have anybody like in your family or anything that was also kind of more geared towards these things?
Yeah, actually. So my dad had gone to school for IT, and I had two cousins that were also in IT. And one of my cousins in particular, Dave, he had just a massive amount of computer equipment. He used to do computer repair as like a side job, and he also worked for small companies as like a contractor. And he just brought home all sorts of stuff. And whenever I'd go see him, he'd just say, hey, you know, take a look around, whatever you want to take, go ahead and, you know, build it. And so I just would go over to his house, and he had like floor to ceiling, just computer parts, anything you could think of, he had it in his basement. And it was like, I was a kid in a candy shop. I would just take all this stuff and go home and just Frankenstein stuff together. It was just a really cool opportunity as a kid. I was probably about 12 years old at the time.
Oh my gosh, that's awesome. I love that. Do you have any like of your favorite things that you, like you said, Frankenstein together?
So actually, yeah, I have quite a lot of stuff. So IoT is kind of a passion of mine in particular. I have like Raspberry Pi computers everywhere in my apartment that just kind of control everything. So I have a bird, and one of the things that I built for my bird is kind of my own thermostat. So I have air purifiers that are controlled using a sensor that talk back to a Raspberry Pi. And then the Raspberry Pi sends a signal, which enables the air purifiers and the thermostat in my apartment to turn on and off based on the purity of the air and the temperature.
That's awesome. I love that.
Yeah.
Very cool. What kind of bird is it?
I have a Quaker parrot. He's about 3 years old now.
Oh, nice. Parrots live a long time, don't they?
Yeah, he lives about 30 years.
Oh,
and
yeah.
He's actually named after one of my favorite people, Linus Torvald, who is the creator of Linux.
Of course. You had to name your bird something like that, right?
Yeah.
So let's get into kind of more specifics of what you're working on now and maybe what you guys are working on in the future. We've talked about RideCare. We mentioned that in the intro. But what is that? What does that mean? And can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah, RideCare is a team within Bosch's cross-domain computing division, and its primary focus is utilizing the advances in AI technology along with a plethora of state-of-the-art sensors in order to ensure ride-sharing and ride-hailing services can offer a safer and cleaner experience for our customers.
Okay, so what does that mean? Like, so ride-sharing, ride-hailing, to me, I think of like, you know, Lyft and Uber. Is this what we're talking about?
Yeah, Uber, Lyft, okay. Zipcar, and right now it's focused on ride sharing and ride hailing, but the future of our products, we're actually aiming to go even further into autonomy with shared autonomous vehicles.
Nice. Okay. So this is kind of laying a foundation for that.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of talked about, you know, it's got sensors, it's sensing technology that can kind of make it safer and cleaner. How do we, like, what does that mean? How does it make it safer and cleaner? What are we detecting in the vehicle that wouldn't be safe? And how does that work? Does it, I guess, go ahead and explain.
Yeah. So in particular, one of our products, RideCare Insight, it's a smart smoke detector that's actually made for fleet vehicles. And it's mounted on the windshield of the vehicle. And this device is actually equipped with more than just a smoke sensor, but also an accelerometer gyroscope, which we use for also detecting damage inside the vehicle. Or damage to the vehicle. So for example, if somebody rents a vehicle from some type of rental service or some type of service that owns a fleet of vehicles and they have our device equipped, if they smoke in the vehicle, we can detect that and we can let our customer know, hey, somebody's smoking in your vehicle.
Mm.
We can also use our accelerometer and gyroscope to detect if there's any type of small damage to the vehicle, such as like a bump or a scrape, or even harsh driving. So if somebody's driving erratically or they're driving recklessly, we're also able to detect that and report that to our customers as well.
Okay, so the report, so when once you sense that, is it like immediate that it gets reported to, let's say, you know, whatever the ride sharing service is?
Yes, so almost immediately after an event is detected and there's a connection between our device to our backend, that event is sent to our customer via an email. But not only an email, the customer also has a dashboard in which they can go into this dashboard and see all of their connected devices, and they can make determination there based on the information provided on what to do next.
Oh, very cool. So I you mentioned kind of the smoke and smell detection. So, I mean, to me, makes sense. You could tell if someone's smoking in the vehicle, right?
Yes.
What other things would you need to smell?
Well, there's plenty of smelly things that can be in a car. You could have like a smelly dog. You could have food, such as if somebody's using like a rental vehicle or a fleet vehicle to do like DoorDash, foul odors like that, or maybe even like a dirty diaper, or we can even pick up bad breath. I mean, that's just specific to the sensor, not specific to our product.
Right.
But there's a whole lot of different things that we're in the realm of looking into right now to see where we can get the most value out of these sensors within our product.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I love the the ability to detect bad breath might be nice for some people, but maybe not maybe not the most necessary. That's awesome. So that's got to be exciting. I would love to hear, you're working on this stuff you're passionate about, you're excited. You've had to have some obstacles or some things that you've had to overcome on your journey so far. I'd love to hear, like, what is one of your biggest obstacles?
Yeah. So one of my biggest obstacles actually has been trying to find my place here at Bosch. So I've worked at Bosch 4 years now. I started as an intern back in 2019. It was a really interesting internship. I got my hands dirty in a lot of different things. I got to take apart cars. I got to take apart electronics, breadboard some electronics. I got to basically do a little bit of everything and was encouraged to do all of these things and more. But in that time during my internship, I also kind of felt like, hey, I'm not exactly a software engineer. I'm a cybersecurity guy. But my team never made me feel that way. Throughout the year that I had as an intern, they made me feel very welcome. They even highly encouraged me to get deeper into software. And so in that year of my internship, I basically went from a cybersecurity professional to a software engineer. It wasn't like I was abandoning my cybersecurity, you know, goals. It was more like I was rolling them into this new path that I wanted to take in life.
That's really neat. I love that. I love that you had the support to continue growing and kind of seeing what unfolded for you.
Yeah. Yeah, it's been an awesome experience.
Oh, that's great. So with that, I mean, what do you feel like you're the most proud of or the most excited about?
Well, I would have to say I'm most proud of my achievements and where I'm at and where I've come from. I grew up in a low-income single mother household, and so I've had to work extraordinarily hard to get to where I'm at today. And so to me, it's really exciting that every day I get to wake up and I get to see that my dreams of working in a prominent tech company are actually, you know, coming to life.
That's awesome. I love it. That's very inspiring. So your mom must be proud.
Oh, yeah. My grandparents, too, actually. My grandparents are actually who have helped me a lot in getting to school and getting into college and everything. I know they're really proud, and it makes me really happy to know that I've got my grandparents and my mom rooting for me and the rest of my family and friends, too.
Yeah, that's awesome. It takes support, you know, to chase after things for sure. Teamwork makes the dream work, right?
For sure.
So what is your best piece of advice? I love asking this question because everyone has a different perspective, and this can be career or personal.
Well, I have a bit of personal advice. I'm very much a philosophical person, and I would basically just put it as my best piece of advice is give it a try. Whatever it may be, give it a try. You never know where an open door might lead you. And who knows, you might find out that what you didn't know was what you were looking for all along.
Oh, I really like that. That's really good. You're right. A lot of times we box ourselves in, right? We think of all the what ifs, or we think we know what we're looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Stephen, this has been so good. I appreciate your time so much. Is there anything that you want to leave with the audience?
Actually, yes, I do have something I would leave with the audience, and that's to step outside of your comfort zone, because you never know when your decisions will propel your life forward. And learning doesn't have to stop once you're done with college. Keeping an open mind, positive attitude for learning will never let you down.
That's really, really good. I think we all need to continuously learn, right?
Definitely.
Well, this has been wonderful. I appreciate it. I know our audience got a nice sneak peek behind the scenes of what it's like for you as a software engineer at Bosch. So thank you so much for your time.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Thanks for listening to Beyond Bosch Podcast. In case you missed our other episodes, now's your chance. Go back and take a listen.